name is Professor Sukhatme. 20 years ago, we used to say Professor Sukhatme is a renowned mechanical engineer. Now we say renowned academician, educationist, institution leader. The vibration that I think only enjoys today, I think it was a lot.
Good morning, everybody. A pleasure to be here at IIT Kanpur. As always, a pleasure to be here. And you know the topic I'm going to speak on, overseeing academic activities, keeping the teaching perspective in mind. I mean, the whole program is about overseeing academic activities, but specifically trying to put a little bit of a teaching perspective into some of the issues that I'll discuss. Now, I said to you that it's always a pleasure to come to Kanpur. From the point of view of history, you might want to note that my first visit to IIT Kanpur was 51 years ago, in 1967, when this institute, I think, was 5 years old. At that time, the Mechanical Engineering Department invited me to give 2 lectures about my research work and so on. It's a very fine visit. Of course, we came by train in those days, and I enjoyed my visit interacting with the departmental members. And it was a very fine set of people in the department at that time. The Mechanical Engineering Department had people like Professor Srinath, Professor Stokes, Professor Shikantaya, Professor Kadambi, and so on, who were all, having excellent academic and research records. And it was a very wonderful time to visit IIT Kanpur. The visitor's hostel had just been built, and I stayed in that, and every time I've come to Kanpur, I've stayed in the visitor's hostel since then. So that was the first visit, as I said. And from time to time, of course, over the years, I've come off and on, not that often as I used to in the earlier years. Now, I see from the list of participants that quite a few are from the IITs, quite a few are from the NITs, and a fair number are also from certain other universities, which are, I think, all centrally funded universities. And you are all fairly senior people, all have been professors for quite a few years. All of you have held administrative posts or will hold administrative posts in the future. And this program kind of prepares you to, shall I say, think about planning for the future if you're going to get into administration. And some of the issues that will come up if you do continue. I mean, all of you, I presume, have been heads or some such position you've held. So the idea is, and it's, I think, a very good idea of the MHRD to have such programs to inculcate or to bring up a set of people who have some ideas of what they're heading for or have some plans if they're heading for administration later. None of us had that kind of training, you understand. I became the head of mechanical engineering in 1973 at IIT Bombay. And I really didn't know what I was getting into. I mean, I'd served on a few committees here and there at that time, but it was a whole lot simpler then than it is today, let me tell you. The point is, it helps to have such kind of exposure through such programs. I'll speak quite frankly. You know, now that is one is retired, one can afford to do that. And I hope you don't mind if I do speak frankly at times. I'll say, well, that was done and that was a wrong thing to do, even if it is at IIT Bombay. I may make such remarks. Treat them as idiosyncrasies of old age or whatever you want. And I expect in return that when we have a Q&A session, that you also will speak up frankly. I mean, don't hesitate. You can say that what I said there was nonsense. Doesn't matter, I'll take it. But you must justify if you say that, whatever you do say.
Otherwise, we'll be nonsense.
Well, something like that. And of course, I have been just now told by Professor Muralidhar that I'm supposed to set some kind of a test for you. I really hadn't expected that. So he said, give a question at the end, and they'll have to give me some written answers. And that's, I think, also a good idea, which at least means that you've been listening to me and not, you know, just going into, dozing off into another world. So I think that's something which is good. Now, loud hona chahiye. To wo, iska volume dekhi, kya karna? आप कर लीजिए जो कुछ करना है
सर. आप अगर ये यूज कर लेंगे साथ
में, नहीं हाथ में नहीं पकड़ना. हाथ में पकड़ने से हाथ हिलता है और फिर वो वॉल्यूम चेंज रहता है. यहाँ पर जा कुछ जहाँ जहाँ भी लगाना हो रहा है. इज दैट बेटर? ओके, डन. ऑल राइट, नाउ लेट मी नाउ मेक सम move on to the next slide and say what is the purpose of the lecture. As I see it, to discuss some issues which come within the purview of academic programs and need to be managed by the concerned deans and heads. That's what we are going to talk about today. And I'll mention those issues which I'll take up just a little in a few minutes. At the outset, however, I want to spend a few minutes talking about the next item mentioned there, that is academic autonomy and accountability. Very often, many people do not realize the power that is given to us at IITs, NITs, and many other central institutes in terms of academic autonomy. We've grown up in an atmosphere in which we think that all power of doing anything with the academics rests with the university to which our college was affiliated. And because of that, faculty, deans, etc., never grow up with the idea that they have anything to do with the academic program per se, setting it up, making changes in it, having examination procedures which suit them rather than the university as a whole, and so on. You understand? We've grown up with that. And even when we are given that academic autonomy, we don't change. And my, shall I say, request to many of you, particularly those who are from NITs, is notice that NIT is not just now a National Institute of Technology. It is no longer a college affiliated to a university. There's a big difference between the two. When you are affiliated to a university, all the colleges, engineering colleges, say, or whatever profession you are talking about, have to follow the same syllabus. The examinations are held on the same day. The papers leak on the same day for all. You understand? So all have to repeat the exam, whether the paper leaked in one town or another. Things like that. Affiliation is, I say, a legacy of the past. If we can avoid it, we should do it for everybody. But it's not feasible to change things for every college, but certainly it's feasible to do it for the certain new institutes. The IITs were among the first to get that autonomy. Now NITs have been given. So to all those who are from NITs and similar institutions, my suggestion to you is keep that in mind. You have powers, you must use them. If you don't, and then you complain, then you are not really doing what you are expected to do. So use that power of academic autonomy. Academic autonomy effectively means the syllabus, the courses, the curriculum, holding exams, correcting exams, marking them, issuing results, is all with the institute. And side by side with it goes the second word, accountability. You are also accountable. Just now if something happens, all blame falls on the vice chancellor of the university. No one talks about the particular college and so on. You understand? Now keep in mind, with autonomy goes accountability. So there is a power given and there is also a certain responsibility. And this is a key feature which needs to be understood by, particularly by institutes which have not had academic autonomy earlier. The other remark which I want to make is, at the beginning, a general remark for all people who enter administration is, don't use that as a reason to give up teaching. Many people do, saying, I'm too busy now, I have meetings, I have to do this, I have to do that, time hi nahi milta, kahan lectures le. The moment you start do that, you are ruining your career. You have to do some teaching. It may be one course in a semester or even one course in a year. And preferably it should not be a postgraduate course with 5-10 students, you know. It should be a course to students which is a class of 40, 50, 60, preferably an undergraduate course. That will keep you live with what is happening in your institute. You can always receive reports and see this is not or that's to be corrected. But nothing like taking a class as whenever, as so long, even if you are in administration. And I suggest you keep that as a, shall I say, request from you, from me to you, if you do take up administration on a large scale. As a director also, I took classes, for your information. I could not take a full course, I used to take half the undergraduate course. But I went on doing it for all the 5 years that I was the director. And it makes all the difference to your thinking. Just it is not just a duty. It's enjoyable. I treat it as something where, you know, you got out from that room with meetings and all that, and here you are sitting with students, freely discussing things, teaching as best as you can, getting queries. It's a different atmosphere. You come down to earth and you really see things with a different perspective. So don't forget this piece of advice which I want to give all of you. Now, let me now move on. And first of all, let me list issues which I am going to discuss today. I have listed 5, but actually I am not going to take up the last. I am going to take up only 4 today. I am going to talk about curriculum planning and development, which is an academic part of the academic programs, some thoughts on them. I am going to talk about selection of new faculty and their mentoring. I am going to talk about MOOCs. All of you have heard the phrase and so much is talked about them. And then I'm going to talk about interacting with students. As I said, I'll delete the last one. I'm not going to take that up today. These 4 will occupy us quite effectively for at least an hour. That's why I'm trying to stick to something which I can spend a little time discussing rather than trying to rush through what I have to say. Now, the I want a little space. मेरे कागज रखने के लिए जगह चाहिए. ये इसकी ज़रूरत है ना? हाँ, बस अब ठीक हो गया. हाँ, ठीक. ठीक. Let's on. हाँ. अच्छा. Now, let's take up the first issue: curriculum planning and development. Let me first of all, before you can plan a curriculum or think of modifying an existing curriculum, you need to first say to yourself, what's the role of my institute? And I've put down here the role of an IIT or an NIT, because I see the role of an NIT as having changed when they were declared as institutes of importance, national institutes. So I see that as a change in their role, and that has to percolate down to the faculty and to the administration in that institute. So what's the role? First, at the bachelor's level, that is the BTech level or the BE level, these institutes contribute a small but select group to the national output. Small means maybe even if you add all the NITs and IITs together, 23 IITs and I think 30 or so NITs, even if you add it all together and you consider the output in a year, it's still only 5 or 6 or 7% of the national output. Every year, 6 or 7 lakhs or 8 lakhs, I don't know the number, are getting BTech degrees. NITs and IITs contribute a few thousand, maybe 10,000 out of it, or 15,000 out of it, or 20,000. You understand? So it's a small group percentage-wise. Next, contribute substantially to the national output at the master's and the PhD level. At the master's level, however, these institutes are supposed to contribute a significant amount to the national output. Something like 50% is what is expected of these institutes, or even more. And at the doctoral level, even more, 75 to 80% of the national output is expected to come from these institutes. So you recognize the role that they are expected to play. Of course, it goes without saying, they have to provide quality education at all levels, whatever it be. And the reason I brought this out is, the curriculum which we have for our institute is dependent on the role which it is expected to play in the national system. So people always say in a college, ye IIT mein bhi ho raha hai, hum bhi karenge. They should, out of politeness, we don't say don't do it. But the point is, there's a different role expected from colleges, from and institutes like NITs or even RIIT. And they have to recognize that. So don't, they should not be copying everything that's done at an IIT. It's not necessarily good for them in the long run. So these are some general statements I've made. The need for a broad-based curriculum in any specialization. Now, I'm going to talk about curriculum only for the bachelor's degree, because that's where we really spend a lot of time in all our institutes when we have academic autonomy, talking about what should be the curriculum, what changes are needed. Every 10 years, we have a big review of what to do. Every semester, one or two courses get dropped, added. Things like that keep on happening. It's something that occupies faculty minds. And all that is coordinated through deans. So the first thing to point out for a curriculum for the institutes I am talking about is, you need a broad-based curriculum in any specialization. And what do I mean by a broad-based curriculum? I'm going to read out to you a statement which was made by the president of MIT 150 years ago. It's a statement which is still widely quoted in the United States. And it was made by William Barton Rogers, who was the first president of MIT in USA. I'll read it and then try to, the English is the usual old style English, so one needs to understand it a little carefully. The first sentence says, "The education we seek to provide at the engineering level, although eminently practical in its aims, has no affinity with that instruction in mere empirical routine, which has sometimes been wanted as the proper education for those who are to engage in industries." The statement made is, we want that education to be practical in its outlook, but it doesn't just mean giving bunch of formulae to students and saying, for this, this is the formula, for this, this is the formula. You don't need to understand where it has come from. You understand? Indeed, he says further, we believe on the contrary, that the most truly practical education is one founded on a thorough knowledge of scientific laws and principles, and one which unites with habits of close observation and exact reasoning a large general cultivation. What is being said in this sentence, which is the key sentence, is a truly practical education in a profession like engineering and technology needs a basis which comes through a foundation or a knowledge of scientific laws. That means you have to teach a certain amount of basic science, be it physics, chemistry, mathematics, beyond the 12th level to engineering students. That's what he's saying. Then is a curriculum which unites habits of close observation and exact reasoning. That means you need laboratories where you do observations, where you do reasoning, you apply logic to some of the data that you're generating. And finally, you need a large general cultivation. That means you can't go out and say, 4 years mechanical engineering, that's all I've studied. I don't care what others are doing all over the world. That will not do in today's world. Today's world requires you to have a general cultivation, which means apart from the basic science you have learned, you also need to have some exposure to the humanities and social sciences. Now, of course, that's a huge field. I'm not saying you can get exposed to everything. Humanities and social sciences implies, you know, economics, sociology, psychology, philosophy, English, Hindi, languages, the literature of those languages. All that is humanities and social sciences. But at least some exposure to it makes the mind a broad mind, and that is what life is all about eventually. Dealing not just with engineers who say the same things that you say, but dealing with the community at large, which will have much wider views and which will have much wider perspectives, and to whom you can reach only if you also have some idea about what that perspective should be. So the teaching of a certain amount of humanities and social sciences is a necessary part of a bachelor's degree program. MIT was one of the first to recognize that in the USA long ago. And in fact, I remember when I went as a graduate student there in 58, postgraduate student, and I looked at the undergraduate curriculum and I saw first 4 semesters, every semester course in humanities and social sciences. I said, ye kya ho raha hai, you know, and they come for engineering. But the fact is, today after so many years, I think that made sense. Not that they teach the same courses. Those days they had courses called Foundations of Western Civilization there, because that was appropriate for their students. Now they have more choice and different courses. But the emphasis on a small exposure, small meaningful exposure to HNSS still remains a part of the undergraduate curriculum at all good universities in the US and abroad, and should certainly be a part of our universities, which we think or want to be the leading universities in India. So I make a plea to you for that. Now, with this as a basis, we will move on to give some data of what exists today. So, keeping these objectives in mind, number one, some subjects in the basic sciences, physics, chemistry, mathematics, and you will be surprised to see, or you shouldn't be surprised, but many are, and some biology. Biology has become a part of our work now. We can't say, like the old days we used to say, he's a good student in physics, chemistry, mathematics, let him take engineering. He's a good student in physics, chemistry and biology, go for medicine. Those days are over. The distinctions are not that and shouldn't be that. So if it is possible, I'm not saying it is, but certainly some exposure to biology. Even an elementary course makes a lot of difference. And for instance, Bombay now has a course in the first year in biology. We have a whole department, in fact, for biological sciences and engineering. Then, as a step forward from basic sciences, you move to the applied, you move to the engineering sciences, which depend on the particular discipline that you are studying. If it's, say, mechanical engineering, which is my discipline, the engineering sciences that we teach are solid mechanics, fluid mechanics, heat transfer, thermodynamics. These are our basic engineering sciences from which everything flows. So we teach a one-month course in all of these. Then comes applied engineering, which is a host of courses, and it depends on the emphasis you want to give. You'll always have to have some courses in energy conversion, some courses in manufacturing, some courses in design. How much and what is up to the particular institute, what to emphasize. But I'm talking of mechanical engineering. Electrical, you'll have similar courses to give. This is the core of the degree program. Number two, 2/3 or 60% to 70% of all the credits will come in this part of the program. Next, a third part is, as I mentioned earlier, an exposure to some aspects of humanities and social sciences. Not all these subjects, maybe a course here, a course there. Perhaps in an engineering thing, you may always want to have a course on economics, because very closely engineering gets linked to economics. But what to teach is again up to the particular university, the particular IIT or NIT to decide. And I am still waiting for the day when our national languages find a place in this. IIT Bombay has made a small beginning, but that's not enough in my view. Hindi, teaching Hindi as a language under humanities or Hindi literature as a subject is very much a part of teaching HNSS, or even in a regional place, some other language for that matter. So I think we need to, when we say HNSS, we still think everything that flows from the West is HNSS. That is not so. There's a whole lot in our thing, which could, in our country, which could well be inculcated into the HNSS courses in an engineering curriculum. Now, the final thing, of course, is side by side, some skills have to be imparted, what we call as professional skills. You, in the old days, for instance, when I did engineering, and incidentally, I am an alumnus of Banaras Hindu University, okay, when we did engineering, the courses were workshop practice and engineering drawing. This was the big thing then. All our first 2 years went in doing either workshop in the afternoon or drawing in the afternoon. We were excellent draftsmen. Good. I mean, I enjoyed it. But today now there are many more things. Computer programming, to some extent, some knowledge of it is an essential part of a professional skill. And now more and more one recognizes that the development of communication skills is also important, whether it be speaking or writing. And if one can incorporate it or at least have them as electives, it is useful. So some aspect of professional skills is a necessary part also of the curriculum. So these are four broad classifications. Now, I'm going to show the credit structure at IIT Bombay. Not that I'm trying to tell you to take this as a model. The idea is to emphasize what needs to be done. This is not just the model, and this is not certainly not the last one. The basic degree that we give, and here credit means if you have a lecture per week for a whole semester in a theory course, then that's 2 credits. And if you have a lecture, if you have a laboratory hour per week for a semester, that's 1 credit. That's how I'm doing. Most, many places do that. Typically, in this means if you divide that by 8, you're getting something like 35 or 34 or something like that per credits per semester. Now, notice the column, which is the last column. Basic sciences take about 20% of the curriculum time credits. The core, department core, is about 60, a little over 60%. The humanities and social sciences about 7%, and the professional skills about 11%. This is, I picked it out what was 4 years ago. As I said, this keeps changing a little here and there every few years. But the basic notions that this is a division which we make sticks with us. We have adopted this nearly 40 years ago, and it's a matter of, you know, one or the other getting a little less or more emphasis from year to year. Now, in addition, we have options for the students. That's the basic course to get a BTech degree. You can get an honors degree if you take four courses with about 24 credits added on in your area of specialization, or you can earn what is called as a minor in addition to your degree, your specialization, by taking 30 extra credits in some area other than your discipline. So mechanical engineering students could do a minor in energy, electrical engineering student could do a minor in energy by taking 5 courses in the energy science and engineering area. And many students opt for one or the other. Many are happy with just getting a BTech also. Now, I've picked a typical credit structure of an NIT. I looked at 2 or 3, okay, just to kind of, so that may not, this may not correspond to exact values for one NIT, but I want you to notice the difference. there is very little basic science taught in an NIT, as far as I can make out. Some may have changed in the last few years, so excuse me for saying that, but what they teach is really what we call as applied science. And There are a fair number of courses, but it's not basic science the way as physics is taught more, or chemistry or maths is taught. The departmental core is about 68%. Humanities and social science is just there for namesake, really, if I may say so. And even one or two of the courses there are usually something about management thrown in, which they classify or say that's humanities, social sciences. And professional skills is 12.5%. So you can see the difference now. And as I say, I've given you a viewpoint. When and if some of you become deans of academic programs, here is an area which I think NITs should profitably start to go. Nothing can be done overnight, mind you. You'll have to discuss within your institutes, your other universities where you have academic autonomy to see what to do. But I do feel that if NITs have to move up the ladder in terms of their curriculum and the quality of the studies which are expected from their students, then a kind of shift of the type I talked about is necessary. It may take its time. I am not saying it can be done overnight. Now, I have discussed these points with you, so I'll not repeat it. Basic sciences really are not taught. There is a case for introducing a course on biology, but it's difficult in terms of credits, whether you have that much credits available to do it. The departmental core could be reduced a little. 68 can become 60% with no real loss. But as I say, these are not easy things to do. When we did it for the first time in 1973 on the curriculum committee, I was a member in IIT, there were tremendous protests from the departments. Because what really happened was that those applied subjects which were being taught over two semesters, many of them had to be reduced to one semester. And naturally, the professor concerned feels his life is at stake, you know, that kind of thing. And so there are, it's natural. They took it in their own stride, you know, and the Senate approved it. They had to do what was required. But that's, everything meets with opposition because there's always another side to what you're trying to do. But a little less weightage would give that freedom to go over to other things and some content increase in humanities and social sciences. These are suggestions. Now I come to the second topic. Am I going too slowly? Yes, I am. I better go faster. Okay. Now I come to what I think is a very important part. If an institute is to flower, is to grow, is to change directions, is to become an institute of national importance. And that is selection of new faculty. The British, when they left us, left behind many legacies. Many people who are nostalgic about British days say, when they were here, everything went properly. You know, selection committees are held carefully. The English sahib or whoever was the corresponding Indian sahib, four other people with ties would sit around a table. Applications had been received in advance, screened properly. Do they meet minimum qualification? One by one, the candidates would be called in. And, you know, half an hour, 20 minutes, and you decide at the end of the day, so and so to be taken, sign the minutes and done, you know, that kind of thing. The poor candidate had no say in the matter, really. He was like, a kind of a guinea pig going through a certain line, either executed at the end or not executed. Not executed means selected at the end. But really, it was a fearsome process, if you ask me. And it remains still, somehow we seem continuing with this kind of thing. But we've made it a little softer. See, the statutes and all say there shall be a selection committee consisting of outside members and so on. All that we follow. But within the system, it's possible to introduce many of our own thoughts and features which have made the selection process at most IITs quite different. And I want you to be aware of that, those who are not from IITs. By the way, some of the newer IITs have not yet adopted those policies. So what I say is even for them. But let me not go through the old procedures. You know the old procedure. Advertise, call for application by a certain date. In our time, we had to file 6 copies of the application form because there were no Xerox then. You understand? So file 6 copies. Applications are screened. Do they meet minimum qualifications? Years of experience, number of papers, this, that. Constitute a selection committee, set a date, call them and go through a ritual, put it up to the board and inform. Everything was kept secret till that time. And then on that day issue that selection letter to a fortunate few. And once I remember that time when I joined, I said, what about those who are not selected? Do you at least say you have not been selected? He said, no, sir, we don't do that. If we do, correspondence starts with that person, saying, I'm so good, you haven't taken me. So don't say anything. He has to understand, he or she has to understand, not selected. I said, well, okay, kept quiet. But I'm not sure if we still inform them in writing in our institute. You should. I mean, but what I'm saying is, the fear is of a different kind. You understand? Okay. Now, let's not get into that. What are some of the changes which we have introduced, which I think are worth talking about, so that you are, many of you who are not aware of them or are not seeing them at your institute will feel that there's an advantage to it. Now, the really important change which we have introduced, and I think most of the older IITs certainly have introduced, is that we request the candidates to come at least a day earlier and give a seminar in the department. And that seminar is attended by faculty, the head, etc. And they put down their opinions about the candidate in terms of how he or she made the presentation, did they show mastery over their subject, did they answer the questions well, and so on. Different institutes have different ways. They ask individual faculty to put down their opinions, and then the head simply puts it all in an envelope and forwards it, saying, I'm not responsible for this. My job is to forward. In some departments, the head sits down with them and evolves some kind of a consensus, saying, this is what seems to be emerging. It varies. But the point is, some opinion is conveyed. And usually, if that opinion is negative, which is not seen by the selection committee the next day, then generally the selection committee doesn't go against it, because the director says, if the department as a whole feels that that person after a seminar doesn't come up to the mark, I request you not to, whatever may have been the impression in these 15-20 minutes of the thing. And the selection committee usually goes along. So that's a major change which we introduced many years ago, which was fruitful and I think has paid off. But there's much more that we also do. One of the things which we have done, and I think almost all have done now, is we have a rolling advertisement. The old days when you advertised in newspapers is over. You have a rolling advertisement on our website. Applications can be made at any time by candidates who feel they meet the minimum qualification. They are received. And they immediately go through a certain screening procedure. I'm not talking more or less what is done at IIT Bombay just now. And many other IITs do similar things. What does the institute do? As soon as an advertisement is received, it has within every department what is called as a faculty search committee. And that faculty search committee usually is headed by a senior faculty member, not the head, who very often has been a head earlier. That's usually the case. And a few other senior faculty members who represent various groups within the department. I mean, not political groups. Groups like, in mechanical engineering, we have a design group, a production engineering group, a thermal group. So there are senior professors from these. That's how we have. So they are the ones who usually constitute what is called the faculty search committee. As and when applications come, they are continuously screened within the department. And one decision, head of the committee does the first screening. Very often 15-20% of what we receive may meet minimum qualifications, but in spite of that, the overall feeling is the papers, the list of publications sent or the reprints of papers that they have sent immediately show that it's very average quality, just not up to the mark we expect. In which case, a very polite reply is immediately sent by the head or by the dean of faculty, saying that, we have screened your app, we have examined your application, we do not feel it is suitable, and I think it's reasonably polite, and the matter is closed. This happens in 15-20%, though they may meet the minimum qualifications, mind you. PhD, 8 years experience, all that stuff. Then comes the next. You're still left with about, say, 3/4 of the applications of the total that come. Usually, those go through a much more detailed screening procedure. He goes first to the members of the committee, all of them. They individually go through all the papers, the reprints, etc. In their own mind, they then meet, of course, within the department, and they ask things like, from the CV and from the papers, they say, well, what are the plus points of this person? What are some warning signs that we have after reading through it? What's the quality of the papers that have been given? And really speaking, at the end of it, they say, should we call that person for a personal interaction? That means for giving a seminar and spending some time with us, so that we come to know really in detail whether we want to pursue the case. That's what is done. Maybe another 15-20% are not found up to the mark, whatever it be. And that is. Then comes the balance. People who have gone through these stages, and they are usually called and requested to come to the institute. If they are abroad and are passing through India, we say, well, come at that time. You know, we don't say that come specifically for this. In extreme cases where they just cannot make it, we even hold the thing on Skype, an interview. But we would prefer them to come, not only because a personal interaction is just not a Skype type of presentation, but also one in which they individually meet different faculty members in the department. We also come to know what they would like to do when they come back. It's not one way. It's not saying we want this and we want that. That faculty member, if he or she is any good, would also have expectations. They know what salary they will get. That's not the issue. The issue is if they are doing experimental work wherever they are and they need that experimental facility, it will cost money. How much will it cost? We have certain seed grants that we give. Will it be enough or not enough? So we try to get an idea of what are their requirements in terms of space if they are doing experimental work, money in terms of experimental setups to be bought, and so on. It has to be a two-way process if you want to get good people. You can't just say, you meet our needs, come. That will not happen. Good people will also have some requirements which will make it possible for them to continue to do good research work in the future. And of course, with that, if we agree to it, and when they do come, we give that money, but with the expectation that they will also quickly write research proposal to get money from other agencies and so on. So that is a major change that we do, which has been useful. The coming, that 2-day visit to the institute usually ends up in a very clear understanding of what we feel that person can do, and at that time the department then puts a recommendation to the dean, which is to be forwarded to the director, saying strongly recommended, recommended, not recommended. And maybe 20 or 25% of the applications may go through into the strongly recommended or recommended category. Those are the people who will be called for the interview before a formal selection committee. That's the way it's handled. And if they have not been able to come for the visit to the institute, and the interview or the presentation has been only through Skype, then when they meet the selection committee, they'll have to come in person at that time. But then we insist that they come. We have to see the person. Okay. Whereas in the other case, if they are strongly recommended and they have visited us, the chances are, even if they are abroad doing a postdoctoral, can't come second time, we will recommend that even if they don't make it, hold an interview on Skype, but we strongly recommend it. This has also happened. So some personal interaction, either in advance or at that day, is a requirement. Now, it takes a lot of time doing this. And we are trying to find out people whom we want them to stay with us. People who are not so good will always stay with you, remember that. It's the people who are good who might leave you. It's a worry, but that should not be the consideration while taking them. While taking them, you take people who are the best and try to create conditions that they'll want to stay with you. That's the way we look upon it. And I must tell you, frankly, over the last 20 years, the IIT in Bombay has added on some very brilliant people in the faculty, which earlier we never got applications from them, or we were not considered, attractive enough in different ways. That has changed. We now have very brilliant people. And these interviews are held every 6 months now. No advertisement, nothing. It's a routine. Every 6 months, every department has to hold this interview. It may be for one candidate, it may be for 2 or it may be for 10. And at that time, the internal people within the institute who have you know, already assistant professors and are due for promotion can also appear, of course, for a formal interview, but they have completed this thing. So it is, no internal person is also held up on this account, because as the statutes stand, they have to also appear before a selection committee. So both things are getting satisfied in this way. And although it does cost a lot more money to hold selection committee meetings every 6 months for every department, in the long run, these are very often very small meetings. You may have just one candidate, but you will hold it. And if you don't hold it, the chances are that good person will go somewhere else. So you lose that person if you don't do this as a regular habit. So these are some good features we have introduced. And my purpose in describing this is to suggest to all of you who are going to occupy senior positions, someday going to become directors too, that think over this or try to push for such types of changes. Some of the newer, not so new, 10 years old IITs are still following the classical procedures. They have a seminar on the day before, but that's not enough. You need to do a lot more to pick up good people, okay, and push forward the case. Of course, we have gone a step beyond this even at IIT Bombay, which should take place. We have got our alumni to give funds which help new faculty members to set up also early their homes when they come. So apart from the travel grant which is paid, alumni have a separate fund which we can utilize for that purpose to help them initially get going. That also helps, you know, at the beginning. That's not government money. You can use it for the purpose specified. So much for this. Now, let me just come to the next part, which is also, I think, important, and that is mentoring of students, mentoring of new faculty. The purpose of mentoring is to introduce a new faculty member to the processes being followed while teaching a course. He or she is linked to a senior faculty member who is teaching a course and assists the senior person. Mentoring is normally done for a core course, core undergraduate course. Okay. Now, this is something which we've introduced at least in our department, and I don't know if every department in the institute has done it. But we have, and we feel it is necessary. But it has to be done very carefully. It's not imposed on a new faculty member. But many new faculty members who join us are brilliant in terms of their research record, brilliant in terms of their academic record, but have very little experience of teaching a full course. They might have been teaching assistants while doing their PhDs. They may not even have been teaching assistants. And if you join and you suddenly tell, look, from tomorrow or maybe next semester, which is around the corner, you're going to teach the core course in thermodynamics. The person knows the subject. It's not that he or she has not studied it. But teaching it calls for a different set of skills, preparation, which suddenly thrown can create problems. So mentoring means basically you attach the person to a senior faculty member who also is somebody who understands the process. It's not a question of saying, do this, this is the way it's done, this is the only way it's done. No such thing. Just introduce them to the whole process. So the person who has joined basically is like a well-qualified teaching assistant, shall we say. But with that senior person, attending the classes, setting quizzes and tests with that person, grading papers, giving grades at the end, all that is done with that senior person. But at no point does the senior faculty member ever say, this is the way it's done and this is the way you will do things in future. The whole purpose of mentoring will be lost if the senior faculty member insists that his way is the only way. It's to introduce them to a certain process and saying, you take it over now from next semester, whenever that course is to be taught, and you introduce what you think is desirable, not desirable out of this. And we have found that it helps a lot. Many of the new faculty members feel that it is very advantageous to have gone through this kind of mentoring. So it is something which, again, is something which a dean of academic programs or a head of a department has to see whether it is worthwhile. And as I say, it's not being done in every department at IIT Bombay. It's probably they don't find it necessary, or they haven't tried it. It doesn't matter what it is. The point is, we found it to be quite successful. Now, let me move on to the next. I'm still running behind time. Okay, not too bad now. Now I'll go on to the talking a little bit about MOOCs and the flipped classroom. About 10 years or 15 years ago, suddenly the word MOOC appeared. You know, and every other person you met who wanted to try to look busy would say, you know, I've joined this MOOC. And he would rush off to his PC and, you know, log in and do it. And you say, what's MOOC? You know, took me some time to find out it was massive online something courses. Okay. The idea of MOOCs is simple, or rather straightforward to explain. The need, shall I say, the need for MOOCs arose because the number of people who want an education in engineering, science, arts keeps on increasing. In India, as you well know, in engineering itself, today 6 or 7 lakhs pass out every year. In 1947, when we got independence, the number of BEs passing out every year was a few thousand, 3,000 or 4,000. It's grown 25 times or 30 times in India over the years. With that, there's a need for colleges, there's a need for faculty, and costs. Everything is costly. You understand? If you private colleges have come in, but fees are large, much larger even than the government-run colleges. And in spite of that, even if you're willing to pay it, the quality has gone down because you can't get faculty to teach. So, obviously, people are looking for alternatives, not just in India, but in all countries, because of the larger numbers involved. So, MOOCs came into being because people said, we just have to reduce the cost of education. We can't afford it. The numbers are large. We have to give some education, which avoids this interaction, person-to-person interaction, or reduces it completely, and yet we give a quality education. What it means is simply this: you video record lectures one by one, or lectures in modules one by one, make students whom you may never meet online, they see those, they hear those classes. After hearing those classes, after every class or every two classes, there's a test or a quiz which they have to do online, return it. Once in a while, there may be an online interaction with an instructor who may answer some queries, but most of it is really occupied with having recorded lectures, giving quizzes and tests which are graded, and at the end you get a certificate that you've passed that course with this grade, and so on. And if you can do the whole program, you will eventually get a degree. That was the kind of idea behind setting up MOOCs. Now, MOOCs have been successful in one respect, not in terms of making courses available for degree programs, but in terms of giving small courses on different topics. You can look at some of the leading people who supply MOOCs like Coursera, edX, etc., and you'll see most of the courses they offer are not courses which go into degree programs. They are courses on specific topics, 10 lectures, 5 lectures, like that, which have certain quizzes, etc., also associated with them, but not of a semester's duration. There are very few MOOCs which go through a whole semester and teach the same course that you teach in the class. If you go to edX, for instance, there are a few, and in fact two of them are offered by IIT Bombay faculty under edX, okay, and they are quite popular. But the experience of those faculty when you talk to them are, they say a typical course, undergraduate course in one case, I know the instructor, he said, well, about 10,000 registered for it this semester. Said, how many finished it? Say, 80 finished it at the end. Okay. They liked the course because it's a very systematically taught course, quizzes, tests, grading, everything. 80 finished it at the end. That's it. So it is not something you can hang on to. One semester is a long time. One semester is all right when you are sitting in a class, 80 other people are going, you go with them. You know, a herd mentality. Wo bhi pass hoga, main bhi pass ho jaunga. But when you are alone at home, you may not be able to do that kind of thing. You drop out eventually, even if you have joined with good intentions. So MOOCs have not been all that successful. or I should say have not been successful when it comes to degree programs, okay, giving full courses and stretching them over a few years to get a whole degree. They just haven't worked. But what has worked is the following. What has worked is what we call as blended learning. That means you use some of the advantages of having recorded lectures and use that in your classroom, with combined with a classroom. And so let me describe now the flipped classroom, which we have experimented with a little at IIT Bombay in a few courses. The classical approach I need not talk about, but what I said was, I've told you already what MOOCs are, I've told you the limitations of MOOCs, and I'm now coming to the last part, that is, what is the flipped classroom, a type of blended learning, okay? Now, what do we do in blended learning is the following, in the flipped classroom. We have a set of lectures in the form of modules which are recorded for the whole course by either that instructor or an earlier instructor of the course. You can use the same set of lectures with some modifications, videos over a few years. If it's a core course, content doesn't change that rapidly. A few things change which you can add on, subtract, add or subtract. Now, we've used this in the sense, we means many people who have done this blended flipped classroom. The recorded lectures are available, and when you teach that course in your institute or even somebody else wants to use those lectures, teaches, they say, all right, here's the schedule for this semester. Week 1, lecture, recorded lecture 1 and 2. You have to read this by this date and then come to the class where we will have something like a tutorial, an interaction session, either with the instructor or with teaching assistants, either broken up into groups or not. We'll also have quizzes, tests and so on. So you will still have 2 hours of interaction a week, but this is interaction for somebody who's already been through that process, I mean, already heard the lectures. That's the way it's handled. And the general feeling is, if students take it seriously, and most do, at least at IIT, then the whole quality of the instruction changes, because the time which you spend in starting from, very often from first principles in the lecture, is avoided. It's already been heard. And good students, in fact, are already ready with queries that I didn't understand this or I didn't understand that in the lecture which I heard. Now, of course, there are many students who will still show up without hearing the lectures. That happens. And some are bright enough that they can still, you know, manage or go back afterwards and hear it and things like that. So there are always a few things which don't work. But yeah, yeah, they are open, actually. Open. They are open. In fact, it's the one we are using it for is the heat transfer course, in which there are my recorded lectures, with another two of us recorded lectures. And now it's being used, I've retired, but he's using them with another instructor for the flipped classroom. And these are available on NPTEL. In fact, they're open to anybody. They've been used all over the world for the last 7-8 years, okay? The point is, it need not have been that way. This should be lectures recorded even now. But they are available in advance, okay? You can read them at a higher pace also if you want. No one stops you. The point is, the classroom now is really a kind of a tutorial, come explanation of questions, come place where you can hold a test or a quick test or a quiz. All these get, depending upon what's important. And the quality of instruction immediately improves because some exposure to that topic has already occurred. In fact, good students enjoy it, to be quite honest. But not every student is sincere enough to read. We understand that. And then they have to go back and they'll hear you and see the tutorial, do back learning, all that goes on. That's to be expected if you have a class of 60, 70 students. Okay. But it is something where you are using some aspects of digital learning and yet not letting go of the person completely. The personal interaction still remains a key feature in trying to explain one-to-one what are the difficulties. And I at least think it has a future. And if you want to know more, you should talk to somebody in our institute like Professor Fatak, for instance, who talks about these aspects of MOOCs. In our department, Professor Gaitonde, who teaches the heat transfer course, my colleague, he teaches. I mean, these are people who've taught the whole MOOC on edX and now teach with blended classroom. So they have experience. One needs to contact them and to get later ideas or more ideas on the subject. All right. Now, let me move on to the last topic, the fourth. Interacting with students. All right. I'm going to talk about the subject interacting with students in the teaching learning process. I haven't used this phrase so far, teaching learning. I've used the phrase teaching. In fact, it's an incorrect phrase to use. The word teaching must always be accompanied by learning. You are teaching, the other person is learning. I said this once to a student, and a bright student, typical IIT person who replies back to you, he says, "Sir, but aren't you learning anything?" And I said, "You are right. It's a two-way process. I am teaching, you are learning. You are also teaching me something at the same time, which I am learning." I accepted his argument that was also true. So I think it's more appropriate to say the teaching learning process. Now, the receiving side are the students. And there are some disturbing signs, as many of you know, if you teach classes nowadays. In the old days, attendance was given. I mean, it was given that attendance would be good. If you were a good instructor, you never worried about attendance. I mean, having taught at IIT Bombay in the late 60s, early 70s, I mean, class attendance, I never used to take attendance. It was, you could see in the class, 5 or 6 people out of 65 or 70 may be missing for some reason or the other, not well, this, that. That's it to be expected. But you never had to worry about taking attendance. Today, that is not so. Even the best instructors today at IIT Bombay find attendance in first year is the highest. They come with all ideas. IIT is a great place, and it is. But their seniors influence them, whatever it be. The fact is, second year attendance drops, third year it drops more. Fourth year, they have all the time in the world for placements, this and that. Everything excepting attending classes. But they are all bright enough to have mastered the art of passing courses. And many of them will tell you, "Sir, I have to only get a C grade or a B grade. I can get it, you know, a little study on the previous night of the, I'll get it." And things like that. So you can't argue with that. You say, "Well, okay, I mean, what you want to do." But if you are an instructor in the fourth year or the third year, and you teach with, sincerity, it hurts you. Say, "Look, I'm spending so much time and effort, and here are these people who either don't come, or if you insist that attendance is needed, you know, 80% attendance and things, they'll come with biometry or do some fooling with it, or come and sit at the back and play some games, you know, this, that." So many things, distractions are there. And these are signs. The fact of the matter is, this is the truth today, and we have to accept it. Now, what does one do? Or what, if anything, can one do for this, with this response? This is, as I said, the truth. And I'm sure wherever I've talked to other instructors, they say the same thing. Or they'll say, if the class is full, if you insist on attendance, they'll be chatting with each other, which is worse. Because then even the instructor cannot make, you know, really convey anything if he sees so many people talking in front. Now, it's important to sort of go back in time a little and talk about our thing. When people say, you know, we should have MOOCs and we should have, you know, a digital thing means I don't have to see that person ever. We see each other only on a screen, that type of thing. We go back to our ancient traditions, not ours, many countries' ancient tradition, in which there was a guru, a gurukul, and students went there. Okay. And it was in the old days when there was no writing also, 2000 years ago, it was strictly verbal, knowledge being transferred verbally at all our leading universities, not only India but even abroad. Then of course came parchments on which people would write, and then those were writings which could be also read later by students apart from the verbal instruction. Then came printing, so that copies of what you wrote were available. And at that time people said, now that books are there, we don't need these gurus anymore. But that didn't happen, never happened, because it was realized that the interaction with the teacher is not just a matter of reading a book. Even today people say, I can get all the information on internet. You can, but you will never get it in that order or with that degree of importance with which that subject or certain topics are associated. And that comes only from somebody who knows the subject. All right. So some interaction, what comes out of this, what I'm saying is, some interaction is necessary. You can't say digital world today, everything I can do on the PC. You can do a lot on the PC. You can do a whole lot more than we could do. But you can't eliminate that personal interaction in which you are not just conveying the subject, but you are also conveying a part of your way of looking at things to your student. That's what really education is all about and learning is all about. So that's why I tried to bring out the idea of the flipped classroom, saying that interaction is a necessary part if we want education and learning to be really acquired. Now, coming back again to what I said, we are disturbed with what is happening with students. All of us should be. Some classification in our mind is necessary if we teach a course. You see, I'm just suggesting to you that broadly speaking, you can say, okay, I have a class of 60 students. A certain number will be bright students. A certain number will be average or not so bright students. Okay? Roughly. Even amongst those who are bright, there are some are bright and want to learn. Some are bright but casual about learning. They'll come to class, say, enough. You know, I'll clear this course. Don't have to worry about it. Those who are not so bright but want to learn is a third category. And a fourth is not so bright and have lost the wish to even learn. An instructor has to be concerned with the first and the fourth category. The first category, who are bright and want to learn, they have questions for you. You must be willing to step out of hours to meet those queries and keep their interest in the subject. It's a small number, maybe 10, 15, 20% of the class, but you need to worry about them. The last category is those who are average or below average and even don't want to learn. What happens, let it happen. And this is not because they entered the institute that way. They've gradually reached a point where they simply don't care. Now, you might say, well, if they don't care, why should I care? That is not so. They are still young persons. You can do something for them if you take a little personal interest in them. That is where a good instructor comes in. As soon as the first test or the first quiz is over, within a fortnight or so, and if you are watching attendance, both these indicators, you can almost quickly in your mind, without making it obvious, identify 5-10 persons in the class who need attention because they are weak and also don't seem to care, thinking it's written in my, you know, thing that this is going to happen to me. You need to somehow work with them. And working with them doesn't mean identifying them in public. Never do that. A student will always feel hurt if in front of others you say you are no good. Never ever do that. Nobody who comes to your institute should be of that category and isn't. You can do something with it. But so that is where the skill of the instructor comes in trying to identify, in trying to say, suggest, why don't you meet me after the class at this time, I wanted to talk about something. Talk about many things and talk about this. You know, you come to know what is happening. Sometimes you can't do a thing, but very often you can. And at least it was my experience as a teacher that quite a few students benefited from this personal interaction without talking too much about it. You don't go around saying, I'm doing that. And you help students. So I would, as I say, unofficially recommend to you that this helps in the teaching learning interaction. So what are some of the suggestions I've made? Let me just sum up in this last thing. I haven't made this suggestion, but let me make this suggestion since all of you are going to be administrators. The number of students we take in for the BTech program is increasing every year. And many people say at institutes, we have to have a class of 150 in the first year or second year to teach. We don't have any other way. I want to submit to you that if possible, see that two classes The class strength should never exceed 60 or 70 students. Up to 60 or 70, you know, you can see them in front of you. You can identify faces. The moment you have 150, even if a whole semester goes, only the first 20 who usually sit in the front rows are identified to you. The rest is a crowd. You never identify with them, they never identify with you. So if you can, and it is possible, don't have classes of 150. It's all right, you can have mics like I have got, and you can have projections, and you know, all these things are there. You can write on a whiteboard and it gets projected. All that can be done. But it requires rare skills and extremely good instructors to keep a class of 150, what you call, paying attention to you. 60, 70, you can almost see that person. And immediately you can have that feeling that you are reaching out to people. So if it is possible, never encourage classes of 150, however good the instructor is. It's one. And of course, I by now you must have seen, but let me say, yes. We have here, but don't have it. That's all I'll say. I really don't think. Of course, you will have teaching assistants who will take tutorials and so on. I agree that part, shall I say, to some extent helps. But really speaking, it is not the way to do things. Okay. There are many universities in the US, by the way, which as a matter of rule do not have classes strengths beyond 50, 60 or 40. They will have 10 instructors for the course. And those 10 instructors may independently even grade, not even together, so that it doesn't become a big mela trying to keep it all together. But the point is, it is one of the things which distinguishes some good universities in the United States. So I really don't think having big classes is the answer, however good the instructor may be. All right? I'll just finish. Then, as I said, from whatever I've said at the end, you must have seen that you have to take teaching seriously. Teaching is not a subject in which you say, I know the subject, I'll just walk in and lecture. It doesn't happen that way. Teaching is something in which you must genuinely enjoy the business of conveying matter, subject matter to other people. Genuinely enjoy having students with queries. Not get upset even if at times they are a little, shall I say, audacious or a little rude. Not get upset with it. Teaching is a subject in which every time you go for a lecture, you must prepare for it. So that preparation, if you are repeating the course, may involve just 15 minutes. But for those 15 minutes before the lecture, you don't want to see anybody. You want to sit down and plan. What am I going to cover today? What did I do last time? What am I going to, what are some key things which I need to repeat today? And so on. So teaching has to be taken seriously. And very often it is said, if you are looking for a good faculty member, what are the things you look for? You want good teachers, you want good research workers, you want good administrators also. How many things can you expect from a faculty member? I usually say, even if a faculty member can deliver on any two of these two things, of these three things, I'll be happy. Some are very, very good at research, will do teaching seriously, but not to that extent. They will not say no to any administrative work. But if they are great at their research, I'll say do that. Some are excellent teachers. They'll say, I'm not going to do any research. I don't want to guide any PhDs. But my teaching will be flawless. I'll set quizzes, answers, meet students after class for any number of hours to sort out problems. They are born teachers and students love them. Okay? So you need to encourage faculty members of all types under you. Don't say, this institute requires you to do teaching, this institute requires you to do research in good publications, in good journals, this institute requires you to do some administration. So everyone in something or the other, if they can do one of, even two of them, it's more than enough. Then, and I think this is very important, you need to treat students in a fair manner and with dignity. This is something many faculty members over a period of time tend to forget. Largely because students being young are often, shall I say, audacious in the way they talk to you, or rude, shall I say, in the way they talk to you. But you must remember there's an age difference. That person is still growing up. You have grown up. You must take those things and yet not lose your way of being fair in your arguments with them or talking to them. It doesn't pay to lose your temper. It doesn't pay. In the long run, you get more hurt by it than even the students. Another important point is you have to be accessible to students. Every one of us as teachers has to give a certain number of hours when we would be available for students taking our course for answering queries. Maybe 1 hour a week, 2 hours a week. Put it on the door of your room on a timetable and say, I will be there. And whoever comes, nobody may come, one may come, two may come, whatever be the queries, answer them. That personal rapport with one or two or four students or 10 students who come goes a long way in helping them, and they appreciate it. Don't ever give an hour and be missing but from your office at that time, unless there's some really important reason. And as I said earlier, and I repeat, giving a little more attention without making it obvious to students who are weak pays off. Very much it pays off. In a course where there are 60 students, they feel isolated if nobody notices them, and their performance goes down in that process. If you just give that little attention without talking too much about it, you will see half of them will certainly are good enough to get clear your course. So let me now stop, because as I said, there is more, but you know, I can go on. That's the problem with teachers, as you know, is that 1 hour is usually not enough, but that's good enough. So, Professor Muralidhar is there or he's gone? If he's gone, I can forget asking the question. I should give them a question, right? Yeah, correct. Yeah, I knew. Now, the question is, which I'm sort of thinking about, is about the last topic that I took up, interacting with students. I must have missed some important points here, which concern us today. Either something about the disturbing signs or the suggestions that I gave right at the end. Have you anything more to say on the subject? Not what I said, something more to say on that subject. Okay, any suggestion that you feel, all of you have been teachers, all of you are dealing with students, what have I missed, which you think is important enough and I should have included? Right? This is the question. And that's what I would like you to write about. Yeah. Now question and answer.
Last 1 year,
yeah.
I have interacted with something around 15,000 students about cultural ethos. So about the student, but I mean the student, particularly engineering colleges and some of the few schools, I find they are awfully backward in the cultural ethos. So my suggestion would be, if it can be blended with the teaching, that will be the good thing, so that, but it has to be blended properly and carefully, so that it will help them to have a very magnanimous view about the things, what this cultural milieu can help them to talk about engineering, science, and
other
things. This is my suggestion.
Good suggestion.
Another small thing.
That is where the humanities and social sciences courses come in.
They are not dealt properly,
but if they are dealt properly, then they would take care of your suggestion.
They cannot see through the science and engineering. I'll talk about, because I have done some work on ancient Indian technology and science. So those things are missing in the present curriculum of engineering. So okay. There is a small thing, I just want to comment one thing. Can I go ahead?
Well, depends on Professor Muralidhar.
See, my personal feeling, that this is my personal opinion, that what you suggested 60-70, is little larger number. According to me, it is even going beyond 40. It is difficult to and enjoy, because rather my number would be 20. If it is there, it will be 40 is the uppermost limit.
So far I am concerned, my experience is concerned.
Engineers have to be practical, you see. You see, 20 is an impossible number in today's world. Even when I say 60, 70, it is, so I think it's impractical to say that classes should be 20 in strength. Even 60, 70, you will see that people say it's just not possible to handle the large numbers involved. So that is the issue. Yeah.
This is Sameer Khandekar from Mechanical Department.
Yeah.
My question is, see, we have this physics, chemistry, mathematics, let's say up to 12th class. And my son was in the 12th class recently, and I know the extent of that syllabus. And then we compressed the 5-year engineering program into a 4-year program. Now, the assumption was that some of the things which were taught in the first year of engineering will be done by the 12th class. Unfortunately, we don't have the trust that they have doing the right thing. So we tend to do, let us say, the science faculty has not compressed anything from their syllabus, more or less, when the student comes to the 4-year engineering program. And they have pushed the engineering, let's say, domains into, they have shrunk it. At least in IIT Kanpur, it has happened like that. So the first question is that something which you also feel, or you have some comments on that? And the second thing is that in this process, the innovation component, see, if this model would have been correct, then our students would have been also innovative enough to bring out ideas during their VTech program. And if you compare it worldwide, that is not, we are behind it. So what is that missing in the curriculum? Is it too much of science? Because science is black and white. Engineering is gray. And I'll just take one more minute. I mean, if you have a toothbrush, our students can do strength of materials. They know how to make a toothbrush. They know all the molecules of the polymers. They can talk about it. But the toothbrush doesn't come out as an innovation from our students. So what is something missing. It is very clear in my mind at least that I am not able to find out what is that missing in the larger context.
Sorry.
Yeah, I think we'll first wait for your
response. Well, I agree with you that innovativeness is not something that's coming out the way we would like it. But I see a change at least at IIT Bombay over the last 10 years, which was not there earlier. So what you said earlier that, that innovativeness is not there at all, to some extent that has changed. Partly because we've also created in our institute organizations like SINE, where there are people who can start, incubate and so on. So students already are eyeing those from the point of view, have I some idea which I can start putting in. So I notice it at least as a small but good sign that is happening here. So to say nothing is happening would not be right.
So in this classical paradigm which you have presented.
I know. But
there, some limitations?
There are limitations in the sense time. 4 years is too small.
Yes.
But you can't go beyond it also. There's a limit. Someday the student has to go out and do something on his or her own. So what you mentioned, that when we introduced a 4-year program, the science, trade and engineering got pushed back, didn't happen at IIT Bombay. Both got compressed a little. Both gave a little. I know, but that's your problem. Okay. What I'm trying to say is, both got compressed a little at IIT Bombay, all right, when the discussions took place, serious discussions took place, and that will always remain something which will be with us. But that shouldn't stop us from saying a good basic in science means that you develop certain ways of doing things, seeing things and thinking about things which stands you in the long run. It may not even be innovation. Science is not just about knowing what's happening. Science is also developing a way of thinking logically. That occurs if you learn basic science, particularly at the college level and if it's well taught. Mathematics particularly, you see. So what I'm trying to say is, don't link it just with innovation. The science should show in innovation. It should, but it has other plus points which we cannot afford to ignore. So the battle will always be there in a curriculum. 4 years, you go out, I come in, both push and both get a little, these things will go on. That's the way I see it.
Yes.
Sir, this is my 19th year as a faculty in this institute, and over the years I have seen how the things have been evolving and devolving as well. One of the things I do realize that, I do recall the time when we were giving JEE where in addition to physics, chemistry and maths, English was also a subject.
Yeah.
Students that I've seen over the last few years are more, the problems that we see in the, a challenge for us is because of certain limitations of the secondary education system,
yeah,
which is emphasis towards the end becomes more on the rote learning and pattern recognition. So with that mindset of the student comes, I feel it is for us as a teacher that you, how to inculcate that wow factor that they should, when they get up, feel excited about coming over to the class and listen to the lecture. But sir, in this aspect, I wanted to have your feedback on how do we as an instructors or as a teachers, there's also a course reaction or course evaluation where we are also evaluating. But some of those evaluation criteria or matrix that is adopted, how can they be more better done so that as an instructor, it is very instructive for us how we improve upon pedagogical strength.
Well, what I would say is, and I tried to hint at it when I was also speaking earlier, IITs, in general, have always said, research. And if somebody says, look, I'm going to just do teaching seriously, that person doesn't get promoted, in fact, or takes a much longer time to get promoted. And that is where administration comes in. You see, we have had cases in the past where people who are excellent teachers, outstanding teachers, then didn't benefit, and then they become disgruntled, obviously. They say, They admit that they don't do research, but they get disgruntled because they see their colleagues, moving up the ladder. So I think somewhere we have to have a place in our hearts for really good teachers and find ways of pushing them when they consistently perform well in teaching. Perform is not the right word. When they persistently, conscientiously go on teaching classes and students come back and say there's a magic in the way he conveys the subject. And I think we need to recognize it, and that's where a director comes in. Very often at a selection committee meeting, you have to make a case for people like that, because invariably selection committee members will say, where's the research? Or the last paper he wrote was 10 years ago. And things like that. And you say, well, but for 10 years he's taught Mathematics 1 or Mathematics 2 to a class of 100 students, and he's very strict in grading, and yet students love him. Try doing that for 10 years, I say to them. You won't do it. You won't do it for 1 year. And these are all very good students, some of them, in maths. And maths I took as an example because you are in front. But that's not the point. It happens in physics. It happens in chemistry. We need to give that little bit without, again, as I say, talking too much about it. Really dedicated teachers who put everything into it. The teaching aspect, the correcting aspect, being available to students, bringing up weak students, they need to be recognized. They may be small in numbers, maybe one, two in each department, once in a while. If you do that, the word goes around that even this pays off. And we've done that from time to time, but it has always been a battle. That's the only thing I can say for this.
So students look for stimulation all the time.
Yes.
He was referring to the wow factor. Excitement in every class.
No, there's in every class you can't have excitement. When you see too many.
I am Professor Rajshekhar from University of Hyderabad. Teach management.
Yeah.
I'm also a career counselor. For the past 20 years, I have been doing career counseling, running a weekly car. Most of the time, the parents are students, they are more emphasizing on placement. They never ask for a good college means for most of the students and parents, it's a placement. Even in our universities and colleges also, once they are placed in third semester or third year, they never take interest in academics. The attendance is always a big problem. And once, you know, we are not giving attendance, the placement officer will come and they are already recruited to them attendance. The junior students will come to know that this is the trend. Gradually, as you said, the attendance is coming down from year to year. At the end of the day, the grading of the institution also mostly dependent on the placement rather than the quality teaching. So most of the time we get confused. The placement is becoming the core emphasis. Even to choose the colleges also, students are giving more importance to placement. So how do we handle this basis?
First of all, don't do any placement in third year. Don't allow any company to enter in third year. Absolutely. Whatever is to be done should be done in fourth year, and that too in the second semester. I know it calls for being cruel, and people will shout and newspaper will say things and students will say we are not getting jobs. If you are doing a good job, one semester is enough for placement. In the old days when we were students, there was no placement, by the way. We finished 4 years, then looked for a job. Okay, that was the way it was till 60s. Now in the last semester, if it is done, okay, acceptable. But third year and all, I mean, nobody should be allowed to enter the campus. If they hold it outside and all, that's, you can't.
Competing institutions are very,
let them do it.
Allowing the students to, the recruiters are putting pressure on the institution.
Let them do it. You say we are there for teaching, first of all. You are there to get a degree. Don't compromise on that. A degree is a degree given with a certain purpose. If you do it, others will also do it and follow that. Look, it pays off. Yeah, I know.
Sir, Ramji from NIT Kolkata. Sir, you have shown the table for credits for NITs and IIT, even
266.
Yeah, personally. Yeah.
Sir, what is the appropriate number of credits for UG engineering program?
Well, you will notice there, NIT 1 was 320, about 40 credits each semester. It is generally accepted now that if you want students to learn on their own, think on their own, do assignments properly, that 40 is a bit high for a semester. Okay? Between 35 and 40, it should be. Never exceeding 40. Even 40 is a little on the high side. That's why you will see in the basic curriculum for getting a BTEC degree, it's about 35 at Bombay. We have reduced it. Earlier, we also had 40. We've reduced it to about 35. Only students who want to minor go to higher values. So I think we can do with less, but again, the same problem, which course to drop, which course to add, all that has to be sorted out. There is an issue. But from a student's point of view, if those 35 credits are taught well, then that is the amount you'd stick to.
Sir, I am B. Mishra. I am a student of economics from Northeastern University, Sikkim. Today, after listening to your lecture, I realized, in the light of health, of course, we didn't fit into the scheme of discussions that you had this morning, because you talked about NIT and IIT and process of admissions and course structure. And since I am from a university, I found myself here, interacting with the students in the teaching learning process, and you have given a question on that, on this, the sub-disturbing science. Till today, I am yet to experience any disturbing science as far as my interactions with the students is concerned. What we really do, we try to motivate the students in the classroom by giving them the real life examples, and we try to relate it to the problem of economics. And that solves most of the problems when it comes to maintaining a Guru Shishya Parampara. Till today, we maintain a very good Guru Shishya Parampara. So, the students whom I have taught 30 years back, whenever we meet, at the crossroad of our lives, say, believe or not, they come and touch my feet. This parampara, we are still maintaining it. I do not know how to answer to your question as regards to disturbing science.
So you are not disturbing science.
Very, very good. I mean, that is so nothing like it.
Basic concept we have, I'm Anilal Menon from Goa University. The basic concept we have been following was that instead of higher learning, the research and teaching should go parallel. Especially, you know, we got an IIT, IIC and university, this has to be there. That's what we also follow. But then, in the recent past, if you see, UGC is trying to force even college teachers to have API, annual performance index, for getting their promotion. As a result of that,
you
don't have time to teach. What is your opinion about this?
I'm not going to comment on UGC. I have no comment.
No, the general question is, research eats into college level.
It's a bit too much to ask. Bit too much to ask college level teachers to do research.
To teach the basic,
yeah, that itself is a challenge for them.
Synergy between our teaching and the engineering faculty, for instance. So, of course, we try to motivate them by saying, okay, in a general algebra class, talk about the Google page algorithm, or you know, if you are teaching numerical analysis or differential equations, talk about some plate bending problems and so on. However, there was this kind of discussion also in IIT Bombay once, whether we should try to look and motivate them as why they are doing this calculus or linear algebra or four courses in all basic sciences. So do you think there should be some kind of a component which comes from engineering faculty also to these basic courses as and when they learn them, so that they have a feel of why they are doing it? Because many students who are good do it for the interest of doing mathematics. They end up doing minors in mathematics. All our minor courses are always full, but the majority do not really appreciate, and by the time they reach their parent department in their fourth year and doing the relevant courses, they would have, you know, probably forgotten and they have to redo it. So this is a complaint which engineering faculty members keep saying. So what is your view on this?
Well, this is an old problem. Okay, it's not new. 50 years ago we discussed it, even now we discuss it. Many engineering departments will say, teach the mathematics and while doing it point out the applications in engineering. And many will say, teach mathematics as mathematics. Because mathematics as mathematics has its logic, its strictness, its theorems, its lemmas, which teach you a systematic way of approaching problems. It's not just the mathematics of that particular topic, but a way of approaching problems by setting down, this is what I'm first assuming, and therefore this follows this. There's a logic that you develop. It is that logic that you apply to all problems in your life later on. So I am much in favor of teaching mathematics as mathematics, even though later on he may become a mechanical engineer or electrical. Same, teach physics as you would teach physics to a physics student. It's only two courses or three courses, but teach them with rigor, because it's the rigor also which certainly comes in your mind and you apply to other problems which are not necessarily mathematics.
I'm not asking to mix the math courses with engineering application. I'm asking just that whether side by side there should be some one lecture or something.
No. The one lecture and all is infiltration, I call it. It will never work. No, it doesn't work out that way. Teach mathematics as mathematics. Teach physics as physics. They are beautiful subjects in their own right. Teach them for what they are. Eventually, that ability to think, starting from fundamentals to go on, stands everyone in good stead. Many of our students who have done very well, you know, in management, for instance, and good students, they were good students, say, the reason why I do well at management is, I have a way of coming down and analyzing that problem and applying systematically, logically, what is possible, what is not possible. This comes because of my training of doing things systematically from having learned basic sciences. A large number of students say this to you. Okay. So I would say mathematics as mathematics. Teach it that way.
Sir, I am Vyas from Andhra Pradesh University. You told about basic sciences and technical courses and blending of that. But recently our agriculture council has imposed some of the non-credit courses like disaster management, scientific and technical writing, IPR issue related courses and entrepreneurship development courses. So what is your opinion about this? Non-credit courses besides regular?
What can I do? These are what they call as skills. They would like you to get these skills. But if they feel they have time, you have time, you have to do it. And if it's an order, you have to execute it.
Now, whether it will be good or not for the student in the long run?
Some of them, yes. I mean, you mentioned...
Disaster management? No.
Disaster management is a general thing. All of us will benefit from learning about it. Why impose it only on agricultural students? That's the point. Yeah, that it could be like that, yes. So what?
This is in continuation to the previous theme. Integrating the basic sciences with the core engineering. I'm ESM Suresh Prasad, Head of Civil Engineering, Limited Chennai. There's a model, hunger code inclusion model, diffusion model. How you are integrating your basic sciences courses or the professional on the reflection of the core engineering subject. For example, when I study differential equation, I should be linked with the slope reflection equation with the beams. What they actually suggest, some of the other courses like disaster management or the environmental engineering and sciences, these components can be included in various areas of core engineering so that they will be able to appreciate, okay, I design a building, how much I am taking care on the environmental. So what is your opinion? How to actually integrate? You are mentioning that mathematics should be taught to them. But if this linkage mechanism is missing, they will be facing the problem. Especially on the higher order ability thinking. When we are actually asking on the lower order ability, this problem is not. But when we are moving from lower order ability to the higher order ability, in your Bloom's taxonomy, the linkage is very, very important. If you are not able to link, and you will not be able to perform on the higher order test.
It's a matter of opinion. You know, you've given yours, I've given mine.
Yes, I think what you mentioned, that the implicit understanding of the logic and the rigor would help you to pick up problems. That would be mathematics also.
Yeah, okay.
That in your training of different types of categories of courses, what is the role of the institute core? Actually, there is often a department core and institute core sometimes very important.
Yeah.
There is always a debate how much should be department, how much institute, that's number one. Which we are often, you know, like engineering practice with mining engineering, as you know, many components from fluid mechanics or Schenker materials and all. So that's number one. And number two is the courses that we are taking, like LDACs and all of the new courses and all. Can we give some credit to them? Because unless we give some credit, nobody would like to basically take that. If at all we want to, you know, invite some new intelligences or new ideas to the minds of the people. So some kind of credit accounting in the course structure.
Well, that you'll have to work out for giving credit. Some of them perhaps could be if somebody, a student, has done them. But you need to work it out. It cannot be just said that it will be done in general. It has to be specific. The quality of what is offered there varies widely if you go through lists of courses. And as I said, very few are semester oriented. So you need to work on those, get information on those, then say, look, if you do this, you'll get credit for it to the student concerned. And your other question was the first part about what is an institute core and what's a departmental core. Well, usually the basic sciences thing comes under institute core, you see. Some part of the humanities would come under institute core, okay? That's the way it is done. Some part of the professional skills would also come under institute core. The departmental part is the second one, the major part, which is all with the department. In that also, they may have some electives, which are institute electives and departmental electives. So one can't just break it up and say, this is institute. They are mixed up. The institute core is mixed into all of these. That's the way.
Then you mentioned
it as
core courses.
No, I mean, it's a matter of definition. I defined it this way. If you do institute core, I can separate out and say, out of departmental, this is an institute core, you know, or out of basic sciences, this is institute core. One can categorize further. That can be done. Hello. True.
So, in a basic science course, in fact, I would sort of go further to state that the last portion of a basic science course should have something which is really into the modern ways of thinking, where the student, even if he doesn't grasp the whole thing, if at a later stage he sees some of these things, he will begin to appreciate it. So, just for the heck of it and for the sake of it, one should
it's a good suggestion. Yeah, good suggestion.
Sir, I'm S. P. Chaudhary. I'm professor at MNIT Jaipur. Just I want to supplement about the credit point system. It also depends on how we are accounting for the credit pattern. Like some places, as you said, for you know, say, 2 hours we are giving one credit. But
no, 1 hour is given 2 credits.
1 hour is given to
one lecture hour
is given only 1 credit.
Okay.
And 2 practical hours, 1 credit.
It's half this.
Yeah. So accordingly, you know, the number of credits, the most important indicator is the number of contact hours per. So which is getting converted into credits, as you have shown rightly, somewhere more than 300 credits for the degree. Whereas the AICT model curriculum also showing, you know, around 170-180, trying to bring it to 160. That was one thing.
Yeah.
The second point is, so far as I know, you talked about national language, you know, do we have a national language?
Language, yes, that's what
we have national language, yes.
I'm sorry to say, you please check it. It is Raj Bhasa and not the Rashtra Bhasa. There is a minor difference. And this I could, you know, come to know when I attended a program in that, you know, September, Hindi Pakhwada. So we do not have a national language as such. It's there only for, you know, the official working language in the government, central government offices, Hindi, and in some state government. As a Hindu. That's what I came to know there. So, as such, we do not have a national language. That's what I was categorically told.
We have a last comment.
Sometime back, there were some statistics which said from the top 100 in the 60-70, amongst the top, go to IIT Bombay. Maybe more than 70 also. Not that IIT Bombay is very different from Kanpur or Madras or Delhi or anything. They have their goals set already because IIT Bombay happens to be the financial capital, and then they are all aiming for investment banking and those kinds of jobs. What are your thoughts on this?
No, the reason they come to IIT Bombay is simple. The top rankers in JEE Advanced want to join computer science and engineering. It is the perception in the country today, maybe true or wrong, that the computer science and engineering department at IIT Bombay is the best among all the IITs. That is why the first 60 come to IIT Bombay. All right. Few years ago, say 20 years ago, the best computer science and engineering department was IIT Kanpur. The first 40 in JEE always joined IIT Kanpur. So It's a perception. Okay, that's the reason. It has nothing to do with Bombay being the financial capital. Okay, they're not thinking that far ahead.
So on this note, let us give Professor Sukhatme a big
thank you.